Ms. Usha to introduce our keynote speaker.
It's again a pleasure to introduce my mentor. Our first keynote speaker for the day is definitely the opposite of mundane. A parenting professional, an educator, an advocate for child's rights, a curriculum consultant, an entrepreneur, a school director, an author, a teacher, the president of Podar Education Network, director of Podar Jumbo Kids, leader for Asia of the Nature Action, collaborator for children and 30 years experience in the education industry. Speaking on the topic, bridging the gap between primary and preschool, I now warmly welcome Mrs. Swati Popatwats on the stage. Can you put your hands together, ladies and gentlemen?
Namaskar, everybody. It's a pleasure to see familiar faces, and I'm sure the unfamiliar ones, I will make them familiar by the end of tea time today. How many of you are health conscious? I'm sure all of you are. Well, clapping is a wonderful form of acupressure that keeps you healthy. So I think throughout the day, you should be using that form. This topic is very close to my heart, bridging the gap between primary and preschool. And I'm sure as school leaders, sometimes we find it quite easy and sometimes we struggle with it. So I'm going to make you do a little exercise. Do you all have a paper and a pen or a pencil with you? This is to give you an idea what a pre-primary child feels when he attends the first day in standard one. So I'm going to dictate something to you and you have to write it down. Okay? Can you do that much? Wonderful. Can you write down India? Right. Now before India, put a dash. Now after India, put a dot. Now before that dash, write ECA. And after the dot, write ORG. Now read it, please. What did you get? What did you get? Wonderful. Please Google search this website. And you will come across a wonderful association for early childhood. It's called Early Childhood Association of India. And we have our conference in February, and I can see so many faces here who are members of ECA. Now, what's special about the conference is that we have the industry, which is the early childhood industry, giving out quality awards for teaching practices. So please go to this website. The exercise was not just all about fun. I want you to understand that a lot of things are different in the way a primary teacher teaches. And sometimes in the first few weeks of school, a pre-primary child really struggles to understand that system and ends up either copying from a child next to him or just ends up not doing anything in the book. I could have simply said ECA-India.org, but the teaching practice is always different in the primary. So our focus today is going to be on how to make a bridge between the preschool and the primary school. Can we start the PPT, please? I'm going to show you a visual that best describes this dilemma, going from preschool to primary school. Yeah, can you go to the second slide, please? This is how a child feels. It's a tightrope walk for a child, moving from preschool to the primary school. And if you see what helps the child bridge the gap is what's in his hand, parent and teachers. Only when these two come together and help the child understand the difference between preschool and primary school can this child really survive in the first few months of primary school, because they are the most crucial months. Shall we move ahead? Now, Rudolf Steiner, who's an educationist, a German educationist, divides a child's ages into three stages. So the first stage is called infancy, where you require to give the child and understand that the child learns with imitation, and you need to give the child liberty, which means independence, independence to explore. Even Maria Montessori says the same thing. And the third thing is to understand that children don't drive you crazy just like that. They are not purposely driving you crazy. They are different and you need to understand them. So this is actually your preschooler. When the child moves to primary, he enters the stage called childhood. And here, when you have to handle the child, you need three different things. You need authority. Authority, which means firmness, rules, and routine. If that's not there, a primary child tends to take things lightly. So it's very important that there is some kind of rules, some kind of system which tells this child, this is the routine I will have to follow, and this will be the repercussions if I don't follow these. Because these children thrive on rules. You must have noticed after the age of 6, most children love to play group games. They like to play in groups, and then they all decide, no, this is the rule, huh? You will have to play like this. No, no, he didn't follow the rule, so he's out of our team. They love rules. They thrive on rules. The second thing that they require is equality. They do not like to be compared. And sadly, in most of our primary classrooms, we do have the 5 stars in the class, and the teacher tends to compare all the children to those performing children. So we need to be very conscious about not comparing them to other children. And the third thing you need to do is legal. Now, what did Rudolf Steiner mean when he said legal? He didn't mean take them all to the court if they don't behave well. Legal means, he said, if there is a rule, then the rule has to be followed similarly, consistently and persistently for the entire class. You can't have your favoritism. You cannot say, okay, this child is naughty, so he's going to be punished. And this child was naughty only once, so let's give him a chance and let's not do anything to him. So that's what Rudolf Steiner meant by legal. The last one is for the older children, so I'm not going to get into that. But this is the comparison that a teacher needs to bring into the way she behaves with children at the age of preschool and at the age of primary school. Can we go to the next slide? Now, the preschool child is stimulus bound, which means he has no impulse control. He has no self-regulation. He sees something, he reacts to it, and then thinks later, oh, I should not have touched it. So he's a stimulus-bound child. So naturally, it's difficult to make them follow rules. But as they reach primary, their brain has developed now, and they understand that everything can't be stimulus-bound. I can see something interesting, but I will have to wait for my teacher's permission to touch that something or to explore that something. Let's move on. Now, what is this child supposed to do in primary school? He's supposed to sit for longer hours. Preschool is ideally for 3 hours or 4 hours, and primary school becomes almost 6 hours. So he's supposed to suddenly sit for longer hours in school, which becomes quite difficult for this child. Number two, independently copy from the blackboard. Most preschools do not give them things to copy from the blackboard, and things are already there in their books. But here in primary, the child will have to copy from the blackboard. Number three, they will have to take care of themselves, which means I must know how to control myself. The teacher is not going to help me do that. Whereas in preschool, the teacher knew each child and was able to help each child develop a different way of controlling himself or herself. Goal-directed behavior, which means planning, self-discipline. I must take care of my homework. I must know what is the homework. I must be able to go home and tell my mommy what is the homework, etc. To resist habits and temptations. This is something, again, which is based on the primary child. We expect the primary child to be able to take care of it. The ability to hold information. 6 hours of learning a lot of information comes in those 6 hours, and I should be able to remember it all, because next day when the teacher asks me, I should be able to have that knowledge from my memory. Otherwise the teacher ends up saying, I taught you yesterday, you are not able to retain it. Ability to be flexible, to be able to adjust to change. Sometimes in primary, the teachers are different for different subjects. So I must be able to adjust to each teacher's different style of teaching. Whereas in the preschool, it was one teacher with me throughout the year. So I have to develop that ability to adjust. The ability to control emotions and behavior. We don't expect a standard one child to cry. We would say you are a big boy or a big girl. You're supposed to be able to control your emotions. But we very well accept when a preschooler cries. So that is a huge change for this child. And the ability to make decisions and carry them out. These are the expectations from a primary child. And they are valid expectations to a large extent. Because the child is now older, the child is in primary school. But who is helping the preschooler develop all this and be ready with all this for primary school? Let's move on. Now there's a wonderful book. I would recommend all of you read this book. It's called The Mind in the Making. It's an excellent book to understand brain development in children, especially primary and secondary children. It's written by Ellen Galinsky, and she says that these are the 7 things that education should be able to give children. If education is not able to give these 7 things to children, then that education has not achieved its goal. And the 7 things are focus and self-control, perspective taking, communicating, making connections, critical thinking, taking on challenges, self-directed and engaged learning. Now I'm going to take you in brief in all this as to what should happen in the preschool so that the child achieves all of this and is on the first step with this when he steps into primary school. Let's move on. Now if the child is not given the right grooming, the right skills or skill sets when the child leaves preschool, there are chances that the child will have a lot of difficulty in learning. Some of these can also find its way in the child's learning style. Number one is inhibition. Inhibition is the ability to avoid distractions. Children who have ADD are not able to control themselves when they are surrounded with distractions. Now, what are distractions in a primary classroom? The school bell ringing, a pune coming to take the signature of the teacher on something or the other, the next door class teacher coming and saying, my projector is not working, do you have a copy of this? It can be birds outside the window. It can be a fan or an AC that's making a lot of noise. These are distractions for a child. And the child should be able to phase them all out and be able to look and understand to what's happening in the class. If the child has not developed this ability by preschool, then learning in the primary school becomes full of distractions. Number two, ability to defer gratification. This is very important. What's an ability to defer gratification? It's like if I put a piece of cake in front of you right now, you'll be very tempted to eat that cake. But I tell you, no, wait till 1 o'clock and then eat that cake. Many of us would be able to do that, but many of us would fidget and feel, why not just lick one finger, let's lick the cream. Because it's very difficult for us to defer gratification. Defer gratification means wait for something that's going to satisfy us. Snack box is the biggest challenge for primary children. They have the snack box with them. They know what mummy has packed in the snack box. Now they are waiting to eat that snack box. And many of them are unable to defer gratification. So after some time, when the teacher has turned her back and is writing something on the blackboard, there goes the child down and he wants to eat what is there in the snack box. That's defer gratification. Wanting to drink water at every given point, because in the preschool it was allowed. The child was able to go and drink water whenever he wanted. In the primary school, the teacher has a lot of things to teach, and if the child is going to go every time to drink water, that's not going to help. So defer gratification is something that senior KG should be teaching the children. Estimating time, very important. There, the alarm clock in the preschool is always the teacher. She says it's time to put the blocks away. She is becoming the clock. Here, the child will have a clock in the class, and the teacher would say 20 minutes and I want you to finish writing in your book. So estimating time remaining is a very important skill that these children require. And the last is working memory. Whatever I learn in school, I'm supposed to retain it and be able to use it the next day. That's called my working memory. Now, all these are supposed to be developed in preschool. Let's move on to the next slide. Now, how do you promote communication? Very important in the preschool, what teachers should do is learn to give instructions in steps. By the age of 2, a child is able to understand 2-step instructions. By the age of 3, 3-step instructions. By the age of 4, 4-step instructions. And by the age of 5, 5-step instructions. And that stays for life. Most of us are not able to comprehend more than 5 steps given together. And that's exactly what happens on the first day of primary school. This is how a primary teacher would speak. Good morning, children. Please take out your maths book, look at the blackboard, go to page number 82 and do all the sums. How many steps? Good morning. Look at the blackboard, take out your maths book, go to page 82 and do all the sums. How many steps? Because that's how she's been groomed. B.Ed. doesn't teach the teachers how to communicate with children. B.Ed. just tells them how to give lessons. Now, a pre-primary teacher would have spoken the same thing like this. Good morning, children. How are you? Now, can we all take out our maths books? Then she will wait for the children to take out the maths books. Then she will say, can you go to page 12? Rohan, you can't take out page 12. Let me help you. You saw this? Saw the vast difference? Very important by senior KG that the teacher matches the style of speaking of a primary teacher, and the primary teacher brings to the level of this child who's come to her from preschool. Let's go to the next question. Next one. D-I-O-M-O. It's called do it on my own. It's very important in primary that the child should be independent. I'll give you a simple example. We help mentor schools to make them understand how their primary children should be groomed in pre-primary so that they are able to settle faster and easier and without any stress. And we found in one school that the primary teacher was struggling with children because when she asked the children to sharpen their pencils, the children didn't know how to sharpen their pencils. So we found out from the senior KG class that in the senior KG class in the same school, the teacher used to put pencils in the middle of the table, sharpened. So the children would just pick up the pencil and start writing. Now in primary school, they had a compass box, which they were not used to. So first of all, opening and closing that compass box takes a lot of time. Then selecting, because mummy has given 4 pencils. Each of a different color. Which one do I take? That takes time. And then the one that I chose fell down from my hand and the point broke. Now I'm looking around, who's going to help me sharpen it? This is a simple thing which was a discoordination between the pre-primary and the primary of the same school. Because by senior KG, children are supposed to develop some independent skills, some things that they can do by themselves. This is well ingrained in the Montessori system. If you notice, self-help skills are the foundation of the Montessori system. But somehow we think play way means mollycoddling children. We don't allow them to do anything on their own. You want to drink water? I will get water for you. You can't pull out your chair, I'll pull it out for you. So we mollycoddle them. And suddenly they feel orphaned when they go to the primary class. And then we blame the primary teachers. We say they have no training. You know, pre-primary teachers are so good. These primary teachers don't know anything. But there's a big disconnect between the independence level required in the primary and what's given in the pre-primary. So by senior KG, it's very important that pre-primary schools start making the children a little more independent. The next one. Next slide, please. Thank you. promote cognitive flexibility. What I did as an exercise to you was cognitive flexibility, which means things which are done in one way can also be done in another way. There's not always only one way to do something. So now I'm going to help you understand cognitive flexibility. Do you all know Simon Says? So what happens in Simon Says? You have to do only those things which Simon says, right? Now let's try another game. You will do everything that Simon doesn't say. You will not do that thing which Simon says. Ready? Right? Simon says, get up. Sit down. Scratch your head. Simon says, roll around. So you understand, this is cognitive flexibility, which means something that I was used to, now you're going to do it in another way. That's called cognitive flexibility. And sometimes children are not able to understand cognitive flexibility. Simple games that can be done in senior KG is, you're giving them a scene of a day and a scene of a night. You're first telling them, here are pictures of things that you can see in the day and things that you can see in the night. Put the day things in the day scene and the night things in the night scene. After he's understood that, now tell the child, now put the day things in the night and the night things in the day. This is cognitive flexibility, where the brain is able to shift gears with ease. Now, why is this required? In primary, mostly you start moving towards subjects. So English reading, English poetry, and English writing become different subjects, which was not the case in preschool. So it's very important for children to develop cognitive flexibility. Let's move on. Perspective taking. You know, you have the dramatic play in preschool, role play, dramatic play, and we feel, khelte hain. No, that is a very important exercise in understanding perspectives. When I become a doctor and I play doctor, I understand what a doctor feels like and what he does. Perspective taking is very important step towards empathy development. Teacher is talking, I shouldn't be talking, because when I talk and people interrupt, I also don't like it. So that's called perspective taking. And that has to be developed by standard one. Let's move on. So what are the games for perspective taking? The games are, you can play simple games even like Simon says, but keep on changing the leader. So sometimes one child is the leader, sometimes the other child is the leader, and the child understands what it feels like to be a leader and what it feels like when I'm not a leader. So perspective taking is extremely crucial to how your child will settle in primary school. Next slide, please. Ability to defer gratification. One of the best games to teach this is musical chairs. How does musical chairs help? You are going around the chairs. Have you noticed that when you play musical chairs, when the music is playing and you see an empty chair, you suddenly start walking very slowly near that chair. Then you'll start walking very fast to reach an empty chair before that music stops. Ability to defer gratification means I have the empty chair, but I can't sit on it till the music stops. So these games are actually helping brain development and helping them adjust to primary school. Next one, please. Estimating time. Making children race against the clock. Sand timers are the best for this in senior KG. Keep a sand timer in the class and tell the children, before the sand comes down, you have to complete your worksheet. And then let them keep on looking at the sand timer. Teacher shouldn't say, it's only 2 minutes left now, it's only 5 minutes left now. Let children understand the importance of time. Next, please. So, what can preschools do to help the child settle in primary school? Simple things. Number one, these cognitive functions which I spoke about. Doesn't take time. You can make it a part of your everyday curriculum. But when you play these games, you are actually helping this child develop cognitive functions which are going to be required in primary. So that's number one. Number two is, take them on a school tour. Help a senior KG child understand what a primary classroom looks like. Where are the toilets? Sometimes in schools we have seen children wandering around the corridors because nobody bothered to tell them which is the primary school toilet. So they come out of the class to go to the toilet, but they lose their way. So it's very important that you take them on a school tour. Number three, primary teachers should be called down to observe the preschool classrooms so that the primary teacher also understands how she talks to children and what are the things she does to help them settle. Number four, schools should move away from making report cards to having portfolios. A portfolio helps you understand the child right from the beginning to the end. And when this portfolio is handed over to the primary teacher gets an insight into the all-round development of this child. And she'll be able to better understand this child when the child comes to her in primary class. Make them independent. Please stop mollycoddling them in preschool. It's extremely crucial that you make them independent, especially in self-help skills. And the last, you